As an animator, director, and producer, his name appeared on Disney films as Wolfgang Reitherman. But since his earliest years, he's been known as Woolie. And since his earliest years, Woolie Reitherman has had a taste for action.
I started flying when I was about 16. In those days, you didn't even need a license. And a couple of friends of mine got killed, and that kind of jars you up a little bit.
In World War II, he piloted supplies over the dangerous route from Burma to China. And like a young Hemingway, he loved the mountains and the sea.
I used to love the ocean, and it kind of teaches you something. If it's bigger than you, curl up and let it happen and don't try to anticipate it. And those things that really take you along, sometimes it, if there was an undertow, you had to come quite a ways around, which taught you not to panic.
Woolie Reitherman never panicked. After Walt Disney's death, Disney Animation was like a plane without power. Reitherman became the pilot in the hot seat. Action and danger were Woolie Reitherman's trademarks. You can share his sense of adventure here in the Disney Family Album. Reitherman started animating for Disney in 1933.
I was sort of recruited out of art school. And I really didn't want to go to Disney's because I'd heard you made drawings over and over and over.
His first assignment, the Magic Mirror, in Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs, didn't really give him a chance to spread his wings.
What wouldst thou know, my queen?
It was kind of tough because it was held. Someone was talking like this all the time. Now, in animation, what you do is you phrase something, and you talk this way, and then you cock your head over this way, and it gives it a feeling of life. I did that thing over 3, 4, 5 times. I finally devised a way of splitting the head in half by folding the paper. And I'd draw one half of the expression, then I would fold the paper over and draw the other half right on the same line and the same thing so that it didn't jiggle all over the place. And that finally worked. It got me out of a hole.
Lips red as the rose, hair black as ebony, skin white as snow.
Snow White.
In the 1930s, Woolie and the other young Disney artists learned how to make their animation imitate life. They did it by observing life in places like the nearby Griffith Park Zoo.
I think a lot of the time we didn't know what we were striving for, but we knew that observation of life and building a vocabulary of observation about animals and so on gave us a better understanding about movement in general. And of course we were all eager and we were compulsive drawers, and it was great fun to come over here and draw and bring your lunch and whatever and bring a pretty girl over.
The animators knew that their work would have to come alive on the screen, but this was no simple task.
The flower of this medium was to be able to instill life into a drawing, and that meant it had to move. A painting is there and it does have a feeling of life, but it's caught in one instant, so is a photograph. But until it moves, life really doesn't get into that thing called a screen up there until it moves and moves with meaning and making statements. It's not alive.
I wanna be a man cub, and stroll right into town.
and be just like the other men. I'm tired of walking around.
Careful analysis of movement became the bedrock of Woolie's animation style.
We used to watch film at night, usually the newsreels of sports, like horse racing and boxing, and we'd stop the film, you know. And we didn't know really what we were looking for, but we observed that at certain phases, certain things seemed to happen. Well, if I'm going to animate an animal, say running, of course you got to have a kind of an appearance that's the right animal. With the horse, you knew that the back end of the horse was doing the driving, those back feet. And you knew that there was a kind of a series of leaps. So what I'm saying is you'd start out with the front feet, and you knew that they didn't come out this way and do this. You knew that there was an overlap. So you'd start out, and the head would be down, and it would come out and reach. And this other foot was getting ready for the other reach. Now you'd come down, and these 2 feet would hit. And now you knew that the weight of the body was now on those 2 feet. So finally, if you'd go through that straight ahead, and after, well, the first stride or two, you'd really have something that worked, and it was alive.
By the time Fantasia went into production in 1938, Woolie understood movement so well he could animate animals that in real life were extinct.
The beginning of analysis of movement, action analysis, of course, is the skeleton. And we went down to the museum and we saw these big animals on bones, and they're absolutely authentic. And you could kneel and try to figure how they would get all that weight from one foot to the other, how the bones would articulate. And then, of course, the other thing is to draw them so they're always above you. You don't look level at a big thing. You always have to look up at it. Get the full personality of a wild animal, it has to be chased by something, or it has to be in danger, in real mortal danger, I guess it's like watching a bullfight in a way, but it's very exciting.
Using what he knew about anatomy, Woolie also exaggerated movement to comic proportions, as with the crocodile in Peter Pan.
Oh, I know some of the guys criticize me for, there's no crocodile in the world that a man can stand straight up in and hold the jaws apart like that. I says, nobody's going to care about that if it's funny.
The incredible bulk of this rhino made it perfect for a bit part in Robin Hood.
We needed these powerful tank-like creatures that would just form a phalange and just rip through everything. And that was just a one-dimensional beast in a way. Of course, we put clothes on them, gave them spears.
Also in Robin Hood, Woolie cast the King of the Beasts as a neurotic Prince John.
Enough! I am king! 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 Off with his head!
Well, that's a different reason for using a lion. It was a cowardly lion, and the lion is a symbol of regal, of king, and of course he wasn't a king, and he was a scroungy lion and a sneaky lion. And it gave you a real good character. And then, of course, with Peter Ustinov's voice, you couldn't miss.
Oh, the richest plum of them all, Notting Ham. This crown gives me a feeling of power, power. Forgive me a cruel chuckle. Power.
Woolie's instinct for leadership made him Disney's choice to direct The Jungle Book. A movie that blended action and personality as well as animation ever had.
We used an orangutan in Jungle Book because that's actually what Rudyard Kipling had in his Jungle Book story. But of course, we took a great deal of liberties with it.
Woolie took Kipling's orangutan and combined it with Louis Prima's voice to create a unique and zany character.
Crazy.
I'm not as crazy as you are. Put me down. You cut that out.
Cool it, boy. Unwind yourself.
Then something else that moved caught his sensitive eye.
Louis would always bring his band down in a serpentine and walk down through the audience and in between the aisles even. And he'd do the horn at the lead of it and the musicians all following him. It was always a grand finale to his act, and we kept that.
For the voice of Mowgli, the man cub, Woolie had to look no further than his own backyard. His son, Bruce, had the perfect pitch for the part.
There's another fella, another small boy that had been involved in doing the voice for Jungle Book, who came back one afternoon with a voice that was 3 octaves lower, and all of a sudden they needed somebody in a big hurry, and I just happened to be in the right place at the right time.
He was natural, and that's what we wanted. And he was still in that awkward stage, shall we say, that really made him a small boy. I went for personality, strong characterization, strong voices that fit the character.
The strongest personality in the Jungle Book belongs to Baloo the Bear.
Hey, kid, you need help. And old Baloo's gonna learn you to fight like a bear. Now, come on, I'm gonna show you.
We'd gone through a whole lot of guys, and some were obviously trying to be funny and this and that. And finally, Walt came back. He had been at Palm Springs to a party where Phil Harris had been there. He says, why don't you try Phil Harris? Gee, some of the animators said, Phil Harris in a Rudyard Kipling film? And Walt says, why not?
Yeah.
Once we got Phil over there and we told Phil not to be a bear, but to be Phil Harris, he got it in front of the mic and he just tore that thing apart.
Hey, it's up on Rony. Happy people are the up on Rony. Can never be that. Do some of the day, do bump the boot the days, the bones of up on Bobby.
Under Woolie's direction, the animators could get practically any personality into a bear's body, from the bouncing Baloo to the gentle Winnie the Pooh.
Oh, hello. Am I glad to see you? It's more friendly with two. Now, you go that way, and I'll go this way.
That was a whole different kind of bear. That was a whimsy. That was a almost a teddy bear brought to life, and had nothing to do with trying to emulate or get real bear movement.
Finally, Woolie co-produced The Fox and the Hound, in which a grizzly bear brings the film to its dramatic climax.
Well, in The Fox and the Hound, there was a bear too. And he was treated as a real bear. There was really no personality in the bear. Of course, he never talked, which would have ruined him, I think. But he was treated as a real live bear, and I think the picture would have been it would have been quite flat without that kind of a climax.
From 1933 to 1981, the best action sequences in Disney films were either animated, directed, or produced by Woolie Reitherman.
In The Legend of Sleepy Hollow, we did a chase with a headless horseman, and it had all the vibrant guts potential that you could want. And again, I just used the start with one drawing and keep going and see what happens. I'm basically action-oriented and like to get to the extreme of things. I kind of like danger. It's a thrill, and I think it's something everyone should experience once in a while to wake themselves up. I think I always enjoyed a climax, a fight, because it stirred my emotions when I was doing it, and I'm sure that if it stirred my emotions, it would stir the emotions of an audience to a very high point.
Woolie had a whale of a time animating Monstro in Pinocchio.
Of course, the whale was just a huge, big animal. And even though the faster it moves, the slower it takes for all that weight to turn around. But also, the way you get the size of it is because you got a little cricket that's right by his eye. And then you have this huge expanse that gets bigger.
This fight scene from Lady and the Tramp reveals another of Woolie's methods of keeping audiences on the edge of their seats.
I think it's so effective in action sequences if you can stop for a minute, because again, it's just too much to absorb. Sure, you know somebody's getting the hell beat out of them, but it's when you stop for a minute and there's that confrontation that's so vicious that when it starts again, then it gives the audience a little jolt.
And in Sleeping Beauty, Woolie directed the fight scene between the prince and the dragon.
Something's happening all the time of a life and death nature in this sequence. The prince jumps over the drawbridge because it's destroyed by the evil queen. He rides just a short distance, and when he gets to the castle, up comes the thorn, and there's the next big thing. He has to chop his way through. He no sooner does that, and she blasts him with the dragon's fire. I know when I first showed it, some of the guys criticized, well, how'd the prince get up there and all those things. But Walt liked it because it kept driving all the time. I think one of the things that was interesting to me, all through that sequence, I tried to get everybody to think that the prince was going to get killed. We didn't, you know, theoretically, we didn't know. In other words, you were driving to kill that prince all the way through. But that's what I mean is, that it progresses and builds and builds and builds in excitement until man, it if you haven't got anywhere else to go, then stop it right there and do the killing. Walt wasn't afraid of death, whether it pleased or displeased an audience, because he thought that was true to life. And how can you be wrong if you're making a true statement?
I'll kill you for this.
In Jungle Book, we came up with this great idea of letting almost everyone believe the bear was killed.
Mowgli, try to understand.
Bagheera, what's the matter with him?
Got to be brave, like Baloo was.
She don't mean... Oh, no. Baloo.
Not only does the little boy think he's killed, but so does the panther. And then the panther eulogizes this dead companion. And the dead companion wakes up and wants more and more of the eulogy.
For his friend. When great deeds are remembered in this jungle, one name will stand above all others. Our friend, Baloo the Bear.
He's cracking me up.
Come along, Mancup.
Hey, don't stop now, Baggy. You're doing great. There's more, lots more.
Walt Disney died in 1966 during the production of The Jungle Book. Woolie succeeded Walt as producer of the animated films. No one had admired Disney more or understood him better.
I thought he was great without being sentimental about it. He was simple yet very complex. And sometimes very sophisticated, and had an appreciation for newness and a curiosity for newness. He liked people around him that were willing to try and dare, even though they didn't know quite where they were going or why, even sometimes.
For the decade following Disney's death, Woolie's strength held everything together.
There was no replacement for Walt, and in my view, the main thing was to keep this team together and keep the same creative juices flowing that they had with Walt. And I always had little meetings so that those animators who were the key to producing any picture, so that those guys were in on the decisions. And it wasn't a fearless leader type of thing by any means. And you got an awful lot of good input. And when it finally got a little solidified, they felt they were part of the creative process instead of dumping it out there and saying, look, do it.
Under Woolie's team-style leadership, the Aristocrats was the first picture produced after Disney's death.
Okay, let's charge.
Wait a minute. I'm the leader. I'm the one that says when we go. Here we go. Charge!
This was survival as far as I was concerned and most of the animators were concerned. It was survival to keep this thing going. This thing called Walt Disney Animation.
The Aristocrats was a hit. And from 1967 to 1981, Woolie and the team who helped create the classic Disney feature films went on to make three more. Robin Hood, The Rescuer, and The Fox and the Hound. They all carried Woolie's love of character and physical action and a leadership style he developed as a pilot in World War II.
Sure, sometimes I had to make a decision and stick with it. I guess I got this from the Air Force. Once you make up your mind, fly the flight plan out.
Woolie Reitherman made sure the flight plan was at least as dangerous as those he flew in the war. In their imitation of life, the movies that bear his credit pack all the peril of a Pacific Ocean undertow.
And here we go!
Wish we'd have taken the train.
Hey!
as a pilot keeps his plane in the air, Woolie Reitherman guided Disney Animation to new heights.
I remember World War II. When I was flying, the main thing was to keep that airplane up in the air. That was my feeling, that this great group of animators, really the best in the world, needed to stay airborne towards a new objective. We had to keep going onward and upward.